this morning. I praise God for these men who sing and bring praises to God through song and the great job that they do. I praise God for you, his people, that we're here once again, that we can lift up a word out of his holy book. God bless all of you. I hope that you've had a good week. And even if you face some trials and tribulations, praise God in spite of that, because he allowed you to come once again to his house of worship. Amen. Let us pray. Amen. Father, we thank you for this time and this opportunity once again that has been afforded to us to come and share your word with one another, that we might strive, O Heavenly Father, to continue to walk by faith and not by sight, knowing, O Heavenly Father, that there are many things that we are bombarded with in our daily lives, but even in that, we will not compromise when it comes to your word. We thank you, O Heavenly Father, for sending your son Jesus to die for our sins, that we might have that right to the tree of life. Lord, now bless this time that we shall spend together. Hide this your servant behind the cross, that those who are here might see thee and not me. Bless now your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I was thinking back when y'all got married. That was in the year 2010, wasn't it? Right after the flood. I remember now. I thought it was. We had a beautiful wedding, and I was thinking about that time that they've been married 5 years. Y'all hang in there. Y'all will make it. Y'all will catch up with me one day, okay? Amen. God bless you all. For those of you who have your Bibles with you this morning, I'm going to St. Luke, the 10th chapter, okay? And I want to look at the mission of the church. What is the mission of the church? We see a foreshadowing when we study the life of Jesus and the ministry of Jesus. We see a foreshadowing of the church, its foundation. It began, we know, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, and we remember what he asked his disciples of, who do you say that I am? And I can't get off that foundation. And they gave many answers, if you remember, and Peter said, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus told him, flesh and blood did not reveal that. And he told him, upon this rock, this statement of truth, I will build my church, and the very gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, that doesn't mean that the gates of hell won't try and prevail against it. It doesn't mean that you're free from any type of problems or situations as far as this life is concerned once you profess Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. When you profess Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you get deep on the foundation of his word, and you have embraced everything that the word says as truth. You're in a war. We're in a war, and the war is to get us to compromise the very values in which we have been taught by God's word. God's word is true. I don't care what anybody else says, God's word is true. And I can't stress that enough to this membership here at Lake Providence, and it is imperative that we always find our foundation in the word of God, regardless as to whatever is being taught. I challenge, and I want to really instill this into our young people, and especially those who are graduating and getting ready to go off to different colleges and universities. Please know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God's word is true. Don't be shaken upon the foundation in which you have been taught and the upbringing that you've had in your homes by your parents who've tried to keep you on a solid foundation. Don't be upset because of that. Let us look at Luke, the 10th chapter, and I want you to see something real quick. After these things, the Lord, Luke, the 10th chapter, verse 1, and he says, after these things, the Lord appointed 70 others also and sent them two by two before his face into every city and place where he himself was about to go. He said unto them, The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, he says, pray that the Lord of the harvest will send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, he said, I send you out as lambs among wolves. Carry neither money bag, knapsack, nor sandals, nor greet no one along the way of the road. He said, but whatever house you enter into, first say peace to this house. And if the Son of Peace is there, your peace will rest on it. If not, it will return to you. And remain in that same house, eating and drinking such things as they give, for the laborer is worthy of his wages. He says, don't go from house to house. Whatever city you enter, if they receive you, he says, eat such things that are set before you. He says, heal the sick. Heal the sick there. And say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. And whatever city you enter, and if they do not receive you, he says, go out into the streets and say, the very dust of your city, which clings to us, we wipe off against you. Nevertheless, know this, he says, that the kingdom of God has come near you. But I say to you that it will be more tolerable in that day for Sodom than for that city. The mission of the church. When we think of the mission of the church, we think of missionary outreach, we think of mission, foreign missions to other countries, we think of mission into our own community in which we serve to do exactly what Christ has instructed us to do, to reach out to the needy, those who are less fortunate, those who are the underprivileged as far as society is concerned, but also embraced around that is to share with them the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus is sending his disciples out. This is 70 that he is sending out. You remember, we only think of the 12 usually, but this particular chapter says he's sending out 70. He's sending them out two by two in teams to go to those areas as to where he himself would come at a later time to preach. He has instructed them as to what their duties and their responsibilities are. The responsibilities: teach, preach, heal their sick, if there be any among them. Live upright before them. Don't be a bad example to the community in which you go into. That's what he's talking about. Don't be running from house to house to house to house. He says, enter that house. And if the Son of Peace is there, your peace will rest up on that home. In other words, stay there, fellowship with those in the house, and people in the city, when you preach, will be drawn to the ministry in which you have been called out to perform in that city in which you have been sent. They will know that the kingdom has come near to them simply because of the way that you live, because of your testimony, because of your preaching, because of your living and your lifestyle. See, lifestyle is to be embraced by those who walk by faith and not by sight. And the life is not just a style in which changes, but it's one as to where we embrace that we walk in accordance to the will of Christ. We strive to emulate the very character of the God that we served, who came here in the form of human flesh and stayed here some 33 years. Christ himself, we strive to emulate what he did when he was here. That was to show compassion. That was to preach his word. That was to be able to see the commands of God and all of the law fulfilled in his very life. as to where it was a sinless life. Now, I'm not saying that we're going to become sinless, but I'm saying we will sin less if we embrace the principles of how Christ lived. Old things will begin to pass away, and things will become new to us who have embraced the very principles of the Word of God. What do you mean, the principles? I'm talking about what Jesus said when he preached to the multitudes, and he told them, blessed are you when you are persecuted for righteousness' sake. He says, rejoice. People can't understand how it is that you can rejoice, you can shout, you can praise God in the midst of the persecution that might be placed upon you as far as this world is concerned. People don't understand how it's when it talks about blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who have bankrupt themselves to the ways of this world and embrace the Spirit of God, he says, because yours is the kingdom of heaven. What is the mission of the church? The mission of the church is to tell this world that there's good news. The mission of the church is to tell those who are here on the face of this earth that there is life beyond this veil of tears. The mission of the church is to let them know that there is an eternity, and it's either in heaven or hell. When we die, we just don't cease to exist. When we die, it's not over. There is a hereafter. There is something that we all, there's a heaven that we can gain, but there's a hell that we need to shun. That's what our message is. Our message is that we are to strive to be spiritual beings, heavenly citizens on this earthly planet in which we now dwell. That's the mission of the church. The mission of the church. Look at what Jesus says to them. He tells them that they are to preach the word. They are to preach because there's something that is important about the preaching itself. He tells them why? Because the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are so few. What are you talking about? I'm talking about in this world, the harvest. It's ripe for harvest right now. The harvest is ripe for the reaping. Why? It's because this world and those who do not profess Christ, they live without hope. We, as the born-again believers in Christ, can show to this world that there is hope. And the hope lies in the fact that I have dug deep to get on a solid foundation, which is Christ. And he is the hope of my salvation. He's the hope of my eternity. He's my hope beyond this veil of tears. He's my hope in the time of hopeless situations. Because we live in a time and a place as to where it seems like everything is going haywire. There are wars, there are rumors of wars, earthquakes, there's other devastation that is taking place, and there seems to be those who have lost hope. But we are to be the ones to present to this world that there is hope. There is hope in Christ. There is hope in him. Why? Because even though he was nailed to a cross, even though he was taken down and placed in a grave, even though he stayed there 3 days and three nights, there is hope beyond that grave, because I've been told that early Sunday morning he got up with all power in his hand and he declared, death, where is your sting? Grave, where's your victory? I have victory over hell, death, and the grave, and I refuse to compromise on God's word. Look at what he says. Pray that the Lord of the harvest will send forth laborers into his vineyard. Now, that's not saying that everybody who is in the church becomes called to be in the pulpit. That's saying that everybody is called to a ministry of some sort as far as their Christian walk is concerned. In other words, once God saved you, God didn't save you to sit down. There's no retirement in this thing. Do y'all realize that? I think Brother Patton is the oldest male member of the church, and I think he'll be 95 this year. But every time I talk to Brother Patton, every time we have a chance to be on the phone together, or we get in a conversation when he's here, when he's able to be here, he keeps on encouraging. His ministry is that to encourage. His ministry is that of uplifting. His ministry is that to tell you, keep on keeping on. His ministry is that as to where he's not in retirement. See, there's no retirement in this thing. I'm here to tell you, when you retire, they have patted a shovel in your face. And you might be absent on this side, but your legacy lives on, that you lived a good and faithful life. And now when they pat that shovel on this side, you hear the voice on the other side saying, well done, good and faithful servant. Fought a good fight. You kept the faith. You finished your course. There's no retirement in this thing. No. We have a job. We have an opportunity. The mission of the church is to continue to tell the story of the saving grace of a God who did something for us that none of us deserved. There's no one here who deserved to be saved. None of us did. God, do you realize what God could have done when man sinned? God could have just snapped his finger, wiped it all out, and began all over again. But he chose not to do that. Thanks be to God, he chose not to do that. He chose not to do that because of the fact, before he ever placed man here, Christ, and you got to really raise your level of thinking to grasp this, Christ had already died for your sins. Did you know that? It's over in the book of the Revelation when John sees him and he says, I saw one as a lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world. God had put in a plan of salvation before he ever breathed into man's nostril the breath of life, and man became a living soul. God already knew, foreknew, that we were going to have a need to be saved. So he designed a plan, and that plan was Christ. Christ was in the beginning with him. And there are those who will tell you, you serving three different gods. No, I'm not. Yes, I know that he was there in creation. I know that he was there. And not only him, but the Holy Spirit was already there in creation. How do you know that? It's because when it came to the point as to where he formed man out of the dust of the earth, he said, let us make man in our own image and in our likeness. That's what he said. And when he said that and he breathed into his nostril the breath of life and man became a living soul, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit were present. When Christ died on the cross, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit were present. When Christ was raised from the dead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit were present. When Christ was baptized by John, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit were present. There are three, yet they are one. And that's the mystery of this thing in which this religion that we have, this faith that we have in God. The mystery is that we worship him in spirit and in truth. That's the reason we love that first hymn that is in the hymn book. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty. Early in the morning, our soul shall rise to you. God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Here he tells the disciples, I am sending you out as lambs among wolves. In other words, what are you saying? Those wolves want to have lamb chops. But let me tell you what he'll do for you. He'll protect you. The Bible tells me in the Old Testament, it tells me in the Psalm that the angel of the Lord encamps round about those who fear him. In other words, God will take care of you in the midst of your storms, in the midst of your trials of life. When you see no hope, God is taking care of you. When you think that you can't walk, God will pick you up and carry you. When you think that you're completely out of energy, some way, somehow, God gives you his spirit just to fight on a little while longer. Yes, he will, but you've got to trust him, and you've got to believe that he is, and you've got to believe that he's a rewarder of those who will diligently seek him. Are you seeking him today? Do you seek his guidance? Do you seek him in the way that you advance the mission of God's church on this side? I'm here to tell you the mission of the church is to stand in the midst of adverse times. I am going to send you out, he says, as lambs among wolves. Don't get packed up. See, he didn't want you to have a whole lot. He tells you, don't bring your money bag. He says, don't bring your knapsack. Don't bring two sets of sandals. And you got a mission ahead of you. Don't stop chatting and going on with the idle things along the way as far as the roadside is concerned. He said, but enter into the house. He said, now once you get there, hello somebody, thing that's so beautiful, and you know when God's spirit abides with somebody else that you decide to befriend. He says, here's what he tells you to do. He tells you, he said, say peace be to this house. And if the Son of Peace is there, he says, your peace will rest upon it. But if not, it's going to again return. In other words, when we get together, we talk about things that are spiritual things. We have fun, don't get me wrong. And we have a good time sometimes just sitting down and fellowshipping. But the fellowship always leads to something that's spiritual. The fellowship always leads in a way as to where we're discussing God's word. The fellowship always leads in a way as to how can we better advance the kingdom of God. The fellowship leads to some. But when folk don't want to talk spiritual things and they want to talk about worldly things, they want to get caught up in the gossip. Well, it's time for me to exit. That gossip ain't worth talking about. I want to talk about the Lord. I want to have spiritual conversation. I want to hear some good things about God's word. I want to hear how that the Bible tells me that when Christ returns for his church, that the trumpet shall sound and the dead in Christ shall rise first. I want to hear about when we are those who are left behind, that we're still alive, we will be changed in the moment at the twinkling of an eye at the last trump. I want to hear how we're going to be zipping up through the crowds, and I want to grab two sinners in my hand, either one, and as we go zipping up, say, repent or I'm letting go. I want to know Christ, and I want to know him in a way that I draw closer to him, and I know that I am guided through and by his Holy Spirit. The laborer is worthy, the Bible says, of his hire. That's what it says. And then I want you to see what he says, enter into the city. Receive, when you are received there, he says, eat such things that are set before you. That's what he says. He says, heal the sick there. Say to them that the kingdom of God has come near to you. But whatever city you enter into and they don't receive you, he said, go back into the street. He said, when you do, dust yourself off and let them know I'm wiping this off as a judgment against you. He says, because it's going to be more tolerable in the day of judgment for the city of Sodom than it will be for that home or that city in the day of judgment. And we know what happened in Sodom. Today, if you will hear his voice, get involved with the mission of the church. The mission of the church is life-saving. The mission of the church is to live right. The mission of the church is to walk upright in a perverse world in which we are now living in. The mission of the church is to tell the good news of Christ our Lord. As the choir shall prepare to sing a verse of a song, today, if you will hear his voice, get involved with the mission of the church. We're here, and we're ready to receive you if you're without a church home by letter, Christian experience, or candidate for baptism. Our deacons will move out now as we shall prepare to open the doors of church. Come, don't leave without hope, but know that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. May we stand as the invitation is extended. Step out now, knowing that he has looked beyond all your faults. There's need today.